right on to item number two, which is the Pledge of Allegiance. Would you please rise and join me?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And item number three is roll call.
Counselor Bayby?
Present.
Counselor Donovan?
Here.
Counselor Caterina?
Here.
Counselor St. Clair?
Here.
Counselor Blaze?
Here.
Counselor Hayes?
Here.
Counselor Chair Holbrook?
I am here too. And item number four is general public comment. If you'd like to speak, please come to the podium, state your name, address, and you have 3 minutes. Yep. Head right on up.
This is not going to take 3 minutes. I'm Alex Turek. I live at 11 Bayberry Lane. And I have listened to practically all of your meetings and the discussions about the budget and the school budget and how much money we need for the schools. And the children are our future. We have to have this for the schools. We have to have that for the schools. But I have a comment. What about the old people in this town? And I don't mean me. I mean, you know, the old people that are living out there. They live out there on their own. They maybe not get meals on wheels, but a lot of those people are poor, and really poor. If you were to put their taxes up, I don't know how they would pay for it. I don't know how they're living now. So what would the plan be if they couldn't afford to pay their taxes? Would they have to move? They couldn't afford to do that either. Or would the town repossess their houses? I don't know. I'm just curious as to the answer. Okay. Thank you.
And does anybody else wish to speak? All right. Seeing none, I'm going to close the public comment. And item number five is minutes of the April 1st, 2015 regular meeting.
Move approval. Second.
And any errors, omissions, or discussion? And seeing none, all those in favor? That is unanimous. Item number six, adjustments to the agenda. There are none. Item number seven is the treasurer's warrant, which I will sign later. And item number eight is a non-action item, which is a presentation to acknowledge certain acts of bravery. And we have with us this evening our police chief, Officer Moulton, and as well as our fire chief, Mr. Thurlow. And if you would mind going ahead and taking the podium to talk about these acts of bravery.
Well, thank you, Councilperson Holbrook. I appreciate the opportunity. Before I start, I'd like to mention that this year is the 10th anniversary of the Police and Fire Department's Joint Public Safety Awards Ceremony, which is where we honor the outstanding achievements of our first responders from the previous calendar year. And this year's event is going to be held this coming Friday at 5:30 at the Winslow Homer Auditorium at Scarborough High School. And I just wanted to make sure, I know you folks got your invitations, but for the public's edification, I wanted to make sure that they knew that this was a free event and that the public is certainly welcome to this auspicious occasion. It's really a great time, and there's a lot of good things that are done throughout the year, so we wanted to make sure everybody was knew about it and certainly invited. One of the awards that we give during that ceremony is called the Citizens Merit Award, and it's presented to members of the public who have provided emergency aid or performed some kind of heroic deed within our community. Chief Moulton and I are here tonight because there were four individuals who would have been eligible for this award this year had the timing worked out. By the time this event happened a couple of weeks ago, the format and the awards had already been ordered for this year's event, but we certainly plan to nominate these folks for next year's ceremony, and in the meantime, we felt that they deserve some recognition tonight so that they didn't have to wait a full year for this. Could I ask Jason Plummer, Dave Hamilton, Mike Libby, and Jake Shaw to please come up? Well, they're coming. On March 25th, about 3 weeks ago, the fire department was called to a structure fire at 223 Gorham Road, the home of Gloria Heatley and her family, at 10:48 in the morning. A truck that was inside the attached garage caught fire, which spread to the multi-tenant home. Fortunately, Jason and David were at Eight Corners Market having lunch, and they noticed the fire and went over and started knocking on doors to make sure that everybody was safe and out of the building. They were soon joined by Michael and Jake. The owner was home, Gloria, and she's here tonight. And they told her to get out of the building, but for one reason or another, I think she went in to help get the dog out, and she ended up tripping and hurting herself quite severely. So before the firefighters were able to get there and effect a rescue, these four individuals assisted Gloria, got her out of the house safely, and rescued the dog to boot, and made sure that everybody else was out of the building. Having grown up in a much smaller version of this town, Chief Moulton and I, you know, often lament how Scarborough seems to have lost that small town feel that we grew up in. But when you see something like this and you see folks like this step up, you know, it would have been real easy to continue having a lunch or travel on to work and do other things. But for these four folks to step up and do what they did certainly is commendable. And we're here tonight to make sure that the public knows that and to recognize them for their actions. So thank you all very much.
We have certificates here from the town council, and they awarded to each of you in recognition of extraordinary bravery and personal sacrifice demonstrated on March 25th, 2015, when assisting with the rescue of a resident and her dog. And it's signed by Jessica Holbrook, the town council chair, and Tom Hall, town manager, on behalf of the council. So, Jake. Dave Hamilton. Jason. And last but not least, Michael Libby.
Considered the baby of the family. I'm the biggest one, but I'm still the baby. I'd just like to, you know, mention the family just can't show enough gratitude for what you men did that day. Like you said earlier, some people might have just looked the other way and drove off, or just said, geez, that's too bad. And there could have been a life-changing episode there. So again, just can't say enough that you guys are incredible, and don't ever forget it. Great guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Moulton and Thurlow. And again, just to reiterate just how proud I am to see such a sense of bravery and such a selfless act. And again, it just to reiterate what they said, it touches home to that community feel, and that there are those that are caring and willing to help in the time of need. So, again, thank you to all four of you. So, on to our next item of the evening. Order number 15-006 is a 7 p.m. public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendment to the contract zone, Scarborough Realty LLC, the Mercedes-Benz dealership located at 137 U.S. Route 1. So this is the public hearing. Is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item?
It's all the Libby's over there.
Alright, and seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second. And any discussion? And Tom, would you mind just giving us an update what this item is for us this evening?
Well, Dan Bacon's here. If you don't mind, I'd rather defer to him. Just the contract zone process is very particular and precise. This has gone through that process, and I think it'd be helpful for the council and those at home just to appreciate the rigors of the contract zone process. Once he concludes, I do have some parliamentary suggestions that I'd like to bring to your attention. I'll hold those comments till after.
Thank you.
you. Dan Bacon, Planning Director, and thanks for the opportunity to outline this contract zone amendment for, as the manager indicated, the benefit of the public and also newer councilors. There is a contract zone in place that allows for the Mercedes-Benz dealership. That's a use that's not allowed in this particular area of Route 1. So currently there's a contract zone. It was amended once and applies to the current limits of the Mercedes-Benz dealership. They're proposing to amend that contract zone for a second time to include what's now the Sunoco gas station property. So that would expand the area of the contract zone to also apply to that property and to allow for a few different things that zoning doesn't allow for on that parcel, as well as the dealership, the display of outdoor, display of vehicles outside, a reduced landscape setback, and an additional freestanding sign for the dealership. This project's been before you for first reading in the wintertime. It's been back to the planning board for a couple of meetings. They've provided a preliminary approval, which is a necessary step to then come back to you for this public hearing and second reading. That's essentially the process. The applicants are here perhaps to give you some details if you need them on the design. And I guess the only other thing I would mention is that since your first reading, the town attorney and staff have worked with the applicant's attorney and have updated the proposed contract zone amendment. So if you're going to move forward with this evening, you're going to need to consider, or we recommend that you consider this new version that's in your packets. It's dated, I think, April 7th as the up-to-date version of the contract zone amendment, as opposed to the one that you looked at back in January. So that's a procedural step that we encourage you to consider to update the contract zone should you wish to move forward. So that's where we are today.
Thank you, Dan. So if we could just have an overview of what changes took place that you mentioned between the last contract and the one that's in front of us this evening.
Substantively, there really aren't changes. It's more a matter of style. The town attorney has recommended that this actually be cast as a second amendment to the original as opposed to a new contract zone. I'm not aware that there's substantive changes. It's more of a matter of style and to be consistent with prior amendments.
Correct. And the only substantive one I would just point out is that this dealership has been conducting charitable events, special events from time to time at their site, and that wasn't clearly allowed for in the current zoning or the contract zone, so that is one adjustment that's been made.
To allow them to, correct?
To make it clear that those are allowed, subject to meeting required codes. Yeah.
Okay, any other questions? Just food for thought, we don't have debate yet. There's no motion, but questions on the bill?
Dan, can you give us a little more detail on the planning board's review and where they ended up?
The planning board reviewed the stormwater, the landscaping, the layout, and they were satisfied to forward it to you at a preliminary basis. I think they're still looking at some kind of landscaping details that they can do after you approve the contract zone amendment. That they're actually the final step in the process after the council acts. They review the site plan for the last time, and they would issue a final approval once they find that it meets the site plan requirements.
Thank you.
In my opinion, it obviously, I mean, I think I said this at the last time they were here. It's to me, it's much more eye-appealing when you're coming into Scarborough, considering what, not saying that, I mean, we all need gas, but I think this is going to be a much better way to enter town than what is there now. So, to me, it's a huge improvement.
Tori, let me know that I was mistaken. We did have a first and a second, so we can have the date.
Sorry about that.
any other?
Just a question, because I remember, actually, I was sitting on the council when this was approved, and I thought this was a wonderful project. I know that there was considerable retraction or distraction, depending on how you looked at it, around regarding the neighbors and the
neighborhood that, is behind. How is that relationship? Has there been any issues since then? Has it worked well? And does this expansion expose the neighborhood to any issues? Because I haven't heard anything at all from anybody,
right,
which is good.
Since that contract zone process and planning board approvals, there's been some adjustments made to kind of help the transition from a dealership to the abutters. A fence was added that is higher than your typical fence, and also they made some adjustments to the lighting with shields so that the parking lot lighting doesn't spill back towards the neighborhood. There still is, from time to time, concerns about, you know, access in and out of First Street. That's the street that has a driveway that connects to the dealership, and we work with the dealership when we hear those complaints to correct that. So it's not perfect, but I think that steps have been taken to improve what the council considered back in
perhaps those years. The best validation of that is abutters were notified of this process and, to my knowledge, have not come out and addressed this council nor the planning board. So I think that's probably the best validation yet.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Yeah, just a point. Who owns the land? Does Prime own the land, or is it owned by Scarborough Realty?
Dan Doucette, the dealership, the general manager, probably can.
Who owns the land that the dealership is currently on?
Yeah.
It's our realty company, 137 U.S. Trust Realty.
Oh, it's your realty company.
Yes.
Gotcha. Okay.
But we don't currently own a gas station because we have two stipulations. One was that it passed the phase two, which it did, and second that we got the project approved.
So just to be clear, you're an equitable owner. You have it under contract, subject to...
I have it under contract, and, well, I'm ready to close, subject to your approval.
Yes.
Thank you. Sorry. Any other questions, comments,
Peter? I think just, Dale, I may have thought about this before. I know when the first approved, there was some concern about the cars and how close to the curb. Was the planning board look at that and are comfortable with what's proposed, that it kind of stays within sort of the original intent of the first agreement?
Yeah, the planning board didn't find objection to the 7.5-foot setback from the right-of-way. That's one of the requests.
Yeah.
Typically we require a 15-foot setback. I think, speaking for the dealership, that's one of the reasons they wanted this amendment, is they want to utilize this relatively small lot. So the planning board, I think, still probably has some consideration for landscaping in terms of how sidewalk is separated with landscaping from the car display area. But they didn't express objections to that distance that's in the contract zone.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. Thank you, Dan.
Sure.
And
just a procedural reminder to make sure the proper version is properly in front of council. I would suggest that an amendment be offered to replace the version of the version of contract zone amendment to be in keeping with the recommendation of the town attorney.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Mm-mm. On the amendment? All right. All those in favor of the amendment? And that is unanimous. Back to the main motion. Is there anybody else like to speak on the side? None. All those in favor of the amendment? The main motion? Sorry. That is unanimous.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Resolution 15-003 is a resolve to designate May 11th through 17th, 2015.
Good luck with that.
Lung Health Week. Before I read the resolution, Peggy
Pinoy.
Pinoy. I'm going to try to pronounce that right. If you would like to come up to the podium and just talk to us a little bit about the Women's Lung Health Week.
Thank you. I'm Peggy Pinoy. I'm a physician, and I'm a board member of the American Lung Association in Maine. And we thank you for considering this proclamation to make May 11th through 17th Women's Health Week and this Women's Lung Health Week. And lung cancer is the number one killer of women, and yet only 1% of women know that this is indeed the case. We're trying to raise awareness. We're trying to raise funding for this disease to increase early detection and thus save lives. So we again thank you for considering this proclamation.
Very much.
Thank you.
All right, and I will read the resolution, and it is in the form of a motion, which will need to be seconded after I've completed reading the resolution. Be it resolved by the Town Council of the Town of Scarborough, Maine, and Town Council assembled that whereas every 5 minutes a woman in the U.S. is told she has lung cancer, and whereas lung cancer is the number one cancer killer of all women in the U.S., and whereas the lung cancer death rate in women has almost doubled over the past 3 years, and whereas advocacy and increased awareness will result in more and better treatment for women with lung cancer and other lung diseases and will ultimately save lives. And whereas Lung Force is the national movement led by the American Lung Association with the mission of making lung cancer history, uniting women to stand together with a collective strength and determination to lead the fight against lung cancer and for lung health. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Town Council of the Town of Scarborough and the Town Council assembled, hereby designates May 11th through 17th, 2015, as Women's Lung Health Week throughout Scarborough and encourages all residents of Scarborough to learn more about the detection and treatment of lung cancer. Signed and sealed the 15th day of April, 2015, on behalf of the Town Scarborough Town Council and the Town Manager of Scarborough, Maine. And that was in the form of a motion.
Second.
And discussion?
I'm very happy to see this. My mother died of lung cancer in 1999 at the age of 69. I know the impact of this, and she hadn't been a smoker for years and years and years and years, and I've become very much aware of how it is. It's the number one cancer killer of women, and you don't hear about it. So thank you for bringing this forward.
All those in favor? And that is unanimous. And my agenda, sorry. There is no old business at this time, so we'll move on to new business, which is order number 15-027, act on the appointment of a town assessor pursuant to Chapter 200, the Town Charter, Section 204.1, and Title 30-A of MRSA, subsection 2526.5. And authorize the town manager to enter into an agreement with Cape Elizabeth for shared services. And is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comment and pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second.
And before we get into discussion, I will have Tom briefly introduce this to us.
Perhaps it will be helpful just to give a little context for the benefit of the board and certainly those at home. Bill Healy, the former tax assessor, had what he characterizes as his dream job. He unfortunately left our employment, but took up employment with the city of Lewiston, which is his hometown and a job that he's always wanted. That left us with a vacancy for a very, very important position. I certainly invited Council Chair Holbrook as part of the process. We conducted a conventional recruitment process, identified two viable candidates, and at the same time also evaluated contracting for assessing services with Cumberland County. That was not an option the last time. That endeavor is about 14 or 15 months old, and there's, four communities in Cumberland County that currently use those services. And so as part of the evaluation, we very thoroughly evaluated that. And the third piece, just to kind of round out our options, because I believe options are good, is I look to our neighbors as to whether there's any natural alliance and any partnerships. And to my delight, and this is what's before you this evening, I was able to come very quickly to an understanding with the town of Cape Elizabeth for use of their assessor and a shared services kind of model. And the benefits, it's worth just taking a moment to mention the benefits of this proposal. It's the most cost-effective of all the options I looked at. It allows us to maintain the excellent staff we have in place. It also is afforded by some of the unique qualities of Matt Sturgis, who is, in fact, the assessor Matt comes to the comes to this position with a very deep knowledge of commercial assessing, which is a critical, important component for in our tax base. And also Cape Elizabeth has a lot of higher-end waterfront property, which is also a bit of a unique phenomenon in our tax base. Those two things alone really, I think, establish Matt as an ideal candidate. Beyond that, we've got a historical relationship with Cape and Cape Elizabeth and cooperate on many different levels. And I guess the final piece that I'm intrigued with is that though this may be a longstanding relationship, and decades from now you'll be reappointing Matt or his successor to serve in this capacity, but it may not. And I'm intrigued with the sorts of things that are likely to happen in the assessing field in the greater Portland area over the next 3 to 5 years. There's a lot of expected retirements. Yeah, this affords us a level of flexibility to be part of those conversations, where however they take shape. And so for all those reasons, it's certainly my pleasure to recommend to you and consider for your appointment Matt Sturgis, who's here tonight, to serve in the capacity of tax assessor, and also authorize me to sign an agreement with the town of Cape Elizabeth to make that happen.
Thank you, John, for that introduction. And explanation. And the long process it took to get there.
So,
is there any comments?
Sure.
Yeah, I think Tom, I just want to compliment you. I think this is just great leadership in doing this. I really like it. We've talked a little bit about it during the budget process and some of the meetings already about this could very well be a great model for the future to learn from as municipalities and others look to the future. Shared services may become a model that works within the town and also across town. So I really look forward to see how this works out, and thanks for bringing this to us.
I think it's great. Anytime that we can save some money without losing without losing any integrity along with it, I think is a great thing. My hope and goal is that this is a good partnership, and that maybe some of our other areas in town, school department, and other people might see what a great thing this is and possibly look at things that they can do to share some of the services that might help us with our taxes in the future. So I think it's a fabulous thing.
Jim-Marie?
I agree with the comments of my fellow counselors. I think it's a great idea when we can combine forces with other towns and get similar services met. I have dealt with Mr. Sturgis a couple times in a professional manner, and I think he's very helpful and knowledgeable, so I'm very happy we're going to do this.
So I found out tonight that Mr. Sturgis is a counselor in the town of Gray, so he's got to be a little crazy to some extent, I agree with everyone. This is a wonderful opportunity. I do have a more of a technical question regarding item number 7 that's within the interlocal agreement. Because his position is the only other position approved by the town council, what process is going to be undertaken to determine whether this is the right answer in a year?
I'm sorry, could you restate the end of the question?
Sure. So what process will be undertaken to determine if this is the right answer in a year when this expires? Because there's an automatic renewal feature within this unless there's written notification. So because he, although we approve it, I mean, are we going to be doing an evaluation in a year? I mean, have we thought that through so that we know?
Well, the town charter very clearly dictates that the town council makes the appointment, though the supervision is relegated
right.
to me.
Right.
So I would see that as my responsibility to report how the program's working and make recommendations beyond that. Though it may be technically required, and certainly we could do it, I'm not aware that there's been a history here of annual appointments of the assessor. I'm kind of looking to the audience of the staff members. At least during my tenure, I don't recall the assessor appearing before you and being reappointed.
When he was hired, the difference in this is that this is a relationship with another community, so it's not like we're hiring him solely as, I mean, we're entering into an agreement with this with the town of Cape Elizabeth, not really with him. So I just want to make sure, I mean, I'm not, I don't want you to go down the wrong path. I just want to make sure that we have the mechanisms in place to properly evaluate this and make it successful in the future, and that the annual renewals are smooth, and that if there's concerns that are right. So I would assume that as part of the budget process every year, because it would be something that would be included in the budget, right?
Sure.
That would at least provide us with some notification about how he is doing and if this is still a working solution.
Sure, if the council wishes to have some further evaluation process,
okay.
Wide open to that. I don't think there's any barrier
yeah.
to that in this contract. This contract is set up to kind of self perpetuate,
right.
Unless either party wants to get out of it. And there's adequate notification and extraction
okay.
procedures should that happen.
Okay. Extraction.
Could make a better word. Terminate.
There you go. That's a little bit better.
That was a good word with you on the spot.
I think it's a good idea myself. I just have one question. We're due for a revaluation within the next several years. Does this impact that in any way? Would this require, would a revaluation require more than 40% of the person's time?
My expectation, if we go out for a full revaluation whereby you hire a third-party vendor to come in and really do that for you, certainly there is local oversight required of that, and that's perhaps an issue that we need to review in further detail, but I think what's currently being proposed is a full reval by an outside company, so that's what you're paying for, is them to do it. Again, there's some level of local oversight. That's not a foreign concept to Mr. Sturgis, that's kind of on the horizon. The more immediate question might be whether we do move software to a new system, and that will likely require even a higher level of local oversight. These are conversations the council is likely to have in the coming months as
right.
to how quickly you want to move in that regard.
Okay. Thank you.
Bill?
I do support this. This gentleman has a very good resume, as we've been allowed the opportunity to evaluate. I place a lot of credence in the strong endorsement that the town manager, who is, I think, very much on top of these issues. I also place some importance on the strong recommendation and endorsement that he gave to the staff, which we currently have in the assessor's office, and upon the assistant assessor, and that we are well served by the staff we already have, and this will work in a very complementary fashion. So I'm very pleased with where we're ending up. I think we're all looking to save money, and this is a nice way to do it, and without a long-term commitment.
Any other comments? All right. So I'm just going to say ditto to Bill's comments, because those are my comments. one of the unique features about this is, and certainly both, we went through an extensive interview process, and then there was a full panel that interviewed, and they were all very well qualified candidates. But certainly, again, this is an opportunity to have a very respected and very highly educated and very professional individual that we have on board and on our staff, and not have necessarily the full cost of floating that position. The other nice thing about this, and the catch to this is how competent our assistant assessor is.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly is maybe even a candidate for an assessor someday. Certainly she's very bright and very intelligent, and the function of this working is the staff we already have, and they will be able to communicate fairly well and effectively. So again, the other nice thing about this proposal versus maybe a county option is we retain a presence in-house and staff in this building. So again, as we go through, whether we get to the reevaluation this year or not, certainly we have software that we're going to be swapping over and bringing in our, from what I'm told, a dinosaur tax program into a newer, more user-friendly program. So again, having folks that are in-house have that working knowledge, could tell you where that slip of paper is, probably buried down in the basement, is valuable knowledge. So welcome aboard. Welcome to Scarborough. Hopefully you don't pull your hair out too much. And so, pleasure of the council. All those in favor? And that is unanimous.
Thank you.
Yeah, welcome. welcome to Scarborough.
Sure.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And our next order of business is order number 15-028, which is act to approve the resolve to accept donations from the fuel assistance program. And the resolve, which is in the form of a motion, is a resolve accepting donations to the fuel assistance program. Be hereby resolved by the town council as follows, that the town of Scarborough gratefully accepts the pledges and donations from the following businesses and or persons that have been collected and to be used for the fuel assistance program from Mr. and Ms. Jeffrey Ertman. And be it further resolved that each business, organization, and or person be recognized for their generous donation as a token of the town's appreciation. Again, this is a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
I would just mention that Mr. and Dr. Erdman have consistently contributed every year that, at least I'm aware of, that had this program running, so that they're really a strong supporter of this program.
A very big heartfelt thing. Greatly, greatly needed. All those in favor? Item number 9 is standing in special committee reports and liaison reports. And we'll start with...
Good evening, everybody. Last night, both the Coastal Waters Harbor Advisory Committee and the Shellfish Conservation Committee met. I thought it was kind of a nice gesture. Actually, they both committees wrote a letter to David Shaw and the Public Works Department, really thanking them for the exceptional service they gave this year down on the waterfronts and getting 10-foot drifts out of the way so they could get to and from the waterfront. I thought that was a really nice gesture. Secondly, the Shellfish Conservation Committee group worked on a new shellfish ordinance that really was sparked by some Department of Labor issues and other things that would be, they did approve it last night, so it will be coming to this council at a meeting soon, I believe, Tom. They're going to use some of their money to buy some crab traps, and then I think that was pretty much it, although from the Coastal Waters Committee, they did bring up a subject of, as I understand it, this is all new to me, but, you know, lobstermen and everybody else on the waterfront has to have tags on their property. What they did mention is that for the oyster baskets, they seem to be all over the marsh, and there's no way to identify, there's no tags on them, so they're thinking about, just so that they find traps, how do they get them back to who owns them, and also just to make sure it's cleaned up, to maybe think about that. So those were sort of the items discussed at those groups. So with that, I'll conclude. Thank you.
Thank you.
During the past 2 weeks, I had the opportunity to, last week, to attend the Eastern Trail Management District Board meeting down in Kennebunk. And last night, the Eastern Trail Alliance meeting down in Wells. Now, the difference between the two organizations, in case you don't know, is Eastern Trail Management District is kind of responsible for the implementation of the Eastern Trail and the maintaining of it. So they kind of work with the public works departments and the towns in actually getting the work done. The alliance is more long-range planning, high-level planning. They go out and they try to raise money. They have bike tours that they have, more high-level. And they're working on primarily getting easements for all the land that they have to go through in Maine in order to get the trail completed. During both meetings, both groups agreed to donate $2,000 apiece to the town of Scarborough to be used for, the town of Scarborough is in the process of doing an analysis on the gap between Scarborough and South Portland, and I think there's a $12,000 bill on the table for some work that's got to be done. And both those groups coughed up $2,000 apiece to help in that.
the management district wanted to set up a meeting of all the public works managers from South Portland on down, primarily to show what public works should be doing and can be doing on the Eastern Trail. And they wanted Scarborough to host that, because Scarborough is without a doubt at the top of the list in what they do and how they support the Eastern Trail. So that meeting has been set up tentatively, I believe, for May 15th down at Public Works. I think they're going to have a little bit of a display of the trail itself. I guess the trail does go right by the thing. But they'll talk about, Mike Shaw and his people will talk about what they do. Bill Reichel will be there. Bill is on the board of directors of the Eastern Trail Management District, and actually vice president of that. So I found it very, very interesting. I also found it interesting that both groups told me that very, very rarely is anybody in an elected position ever in attendance at any of these meetings. So I guess this is something new, so we'll see. That's it.
Just that the ordinance committee is meeting April 21st at 9:30, so next Tuesday. We've got a lot of parking issues, I guess, in this town, so that's what we're tackling at this point. That is it for me for right now. Am I right?
Was not here for the Conservation Commission meeting because I was away, but they sent me just a note that they are they're doing an inventory of town-owned land, which is interesting because I've told them that long-range planning is also doing that. So I'm on both committees, so that's very helpful. So I'm going to get them to work together to identify town-owned lands, and as the manager works through our list of foreclosed properties and deciding what we're going to do, you know, looking at what lands make sense to hold for conservation, which ones, you know, can we create, you know, a chain or trail of lands that are connected, you know, whatever, or places that the town could use. Also, they wanted me to let the public know that they are sponsoring an Earth Day, April 22nd, 2015, talk at Piper Shores on natural landscaping. And it'll be at 2 o'clock at Piper Shores. And again, it's on natural landscaping. And as the wife of a beekeeper, I can tell you that natural landscaping is essential to keeping of bees. So I encourage folks who are interested to please go to Piper Shores at 2 o'clock on Earth Day, the 22nd, for that. I was away and missed political action committee, so Bill went in my stead. So I'm going to toss that to him. Sorry, Bill.
You all set?
Yes, I'm all done. Okay. Thank you.
I did pinch it for Jean Marie up in Augusta last week for the Maine Municipal Association's Political Action Committee. It's an interesting process. I mean, it's the things that impress you is that the MMA's representative, that I was in a subcommittee room, one of three, was a very knowledgeable, very competent person, obviously a very capable lobbyist on behalf of municipalities. That was very evident. The other thing that really was that struck me was there were a dozen people in the subcommittee that I attended, and they had which is not a lot of people, and out of the 300 or 400 towns and whatever we got in this state, but highly knowledgeable people who were very experienced, brought a lot of expertise to the question of how municipalities would be affected by the legislation that was filed. So I was very impressed it caused me to not say a single word in the in the course of it because I had nothing to contribute to there.
You're probably happy I wasn't there then.
That was true. Last Thursday, I attended the a school board's annual budget forum, which is really a 5-hour presentation. They have all the principals there, all the senior staff. They really go through the budget in tremendous detail. And it really, if you're trying to understand what the budget is about in detail, that's sort of a must-see. And so it helped me because this past week, yesterday, in fact, we had as a finance committee, and I'll let Sean, as the chair, cover most of it, but the one thing that was good was that I was more aware of the issues that the school has before it. And I must say the one thing I will comment on about the meeting yesterday was that the school board and their finance director spent an hour in front of us, and we still had lots of questions left, but the materials that we were given were the best materials that I had seen handed out to really explain why is their budget the way it is. And I would expect that we may actually want to be distributing some of that to not – there's a long ways to go before they're finished and their numbers stabilize, and the changes have been demonstrated that they're not yet stable. They are going down. And where they will end up will remain something that we'll, as a finance committee, monitor. But they were very helpful to understand what has beset them for things that are outside their control and what things are within their control. So that was a very helpful meeting. Also had a meeting with Dan Bacon on the long-range planning committee's effort to have Higgins Beach's zoning have a reasonable match with the way the community actually exists. And so that's an effort that's ongoing with the Long Range Planning Committee and is hopefully going to result in something that will be much more satisfactory from the town's point of view by having zoning that does not necessitate a variance in almost every circumstance and also more satisfactory for the Higgins Beach community's point of view. So I think that was about it. Thank you.
Bill, before you jump up, I forgot something.
Bill, I wanted to just grab you real quick so that I don't forget. But where you were saying that you had talked to Dan, we should probably talk at some point because while working with my Bayview people, we've talked a little bit about how things, how traffic moves down there, and they've had some really good suggestions about ways to sort of get rid of some of that congestion and clogging down there.
Good.
And so maybe some of the things that they've suggested are things that you might have already talked with Dan about, and I'd love to, so that I don't, you know.
Well, thank you for.
Do more, you know, we don't cross over each other. It'd be good for us to maybe kind of talk about that.
Great.
Thank you. Sorry, I didn't mean to jump in.
No, we're not. And I'll just tag in. Thank you. On the same topic.
Mm-hmm.
Long-range planning is going to be meeting regarding these Higgins Beach potential changes first Friday of May. I can't remember the exact date.
Okay.
And I want to say we're going to have people from the Higgins Beach Association there, so encourage your folks, or they can bring things to me, too, where I'm on long-range planning. Because that's good.
That's like they're due for an all-committee meeting.
Yeah.
That's May 1st, by the way. That's May 1st.
Thanks.
That's right.
May 1st. Thank you.
Bill, you were all set with your report?
All set.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay. So Bill pretty much covered the substantive part of what occurred. I do want to really encourage citizens and interested parties to really watch our community cable channel because it was an extremely substantive meeting, and I do want to commend even though the town manager's work isn't necessarily complete yet, this is probably one of the best budget cycles that I've ever gone through from a qualitative and evaluative perspective, and the presentations have been extremely professional, filled rich with data, and the proper arguments or the proper support on what we need, why we need it, as well as the details around the cost. So I also want to extend that appreciation to the school department. And the reason for the substantive point is just their operating budget from a, basically from an essential standpoint, is actually came in at $1.34 million less than what was originally proposed. So there is a significant decrease. Although their overall budget, I think the overall budget, if my memory is correct, went from up like 12.8% to 9.5. So some people may still be critical of it, but we are still working on it. And that's the big piece for everyone to understand. I do want to mention, because we don't have a meeting again until May, is that there's two important meetings between now and then. The first is April 22nd, starting at 4 o'clock, in which we'll hear the final budget pieces around community services, which is going to be a real interesting conversation as a revenue generator. We're also, I believe it's also the administration, and then public works. So that starts at 4 o'clock. And then the next meeting, there's actually two meetings on April 29th. The finance committee, the town finance committee, has decided to meet and fill a time slot there, starting at 4 o'clock to maybe about 5:30 at the latest, since we have another one following. The sole purpose is to start really hammering on the numbers on the municipal side, and looking at what we want to do with that budget. And that's everything, including revenue sources. So we're going to be talking about fund balance. We're going to talk about excise tax. We're going to be talking about all of the components, but only on the municipal side. And then we're reserving our time and conversation until after the public session or the public forum. That's that evening, which is very important. I want to encourage everyone to attend. That starts at 7 o'clock at the high school in the auditorium. And that is our first opportunity to have real, actually it's not the first one because everyone can come to a council meeting, but it's going to be a real symposium or a questions and answer opportunity. We're going to have professional staff and the manager and the superintendent's office and their staff there to answer the specific questions around the budget to as much extent that we can in a two-hour period. So I do want to mention that you should go on to the town's website as well as the school department. There should be a link coming soon so that people are encouraged.
It's up and running now.
It's up and running now. So you can actually go to the website and find the link in which you can submit questions in advance. And we do encourage you to do that because that will allow us to do the research in advance, have a substantive answer for you, as well as try to really properly plan out how we are going to present a lot of information over a very short period of time. So if you can do that, that would be wonderful. I do want to mention, I believe there's going to be like suggestion or a box with cards in town hall and the school department, Tom, if I remember correctly.
Yes, sure.
So they're available there as well. So I did want to mention those two dates in particular. And then the finance committee, we're kind of bantering around an additional date. I do want to mention right now I believe May 4th, so Councilors Donovan and Hayes, we might want to take a look at that. That's when we're going to talk about the school's contribution to the budget and set into place, because it is our goal as a finance committee to make a recommendation to the council for consideration. And then move the budget forward after that. So please share your opinions with councilors on the committee. I also want to mention SEDCO's meeting is tomorrow morning. I believe it starts at 8 o'clock. And ECO Maine is tomorrow afternoon. And I also have a meeting on the PACS Policy Committee. So these are our once-in-quarter meetings type of thing. So there's not a whole lot of information, but just we are remaining active in those organizations.
Thank you. Town manager report.
Thank you. Just three quick things, dates that I'd like to make you remind you of or put on your schedule. The annual municipal officials dinner. This is the Scarborough Community Chamber does it annually. This year it will be on Tuesday, May 19th, 5:30 to 7:30 at Piper Shores. For those of you that haven't been able to do it in the past, it's really a great opportunity to connect with the business community. So I'll redistribute this just to make sure you get that on the calendar. Also, there's a groundbreaking April 30th. That's a Thursday at 10 a.m. This is up at 700 Gallery Boulevard. This is for the, I think it's about 110,000 square foot of retail space that's being built across from Lowe's and adjacent to Walmart, if you can picture that lot. So there'll be a groundbreaking opportunity again Thursday, April 30th at 10 a.m. And lastly, I just want to mention we've been successful in working with the property owner at 341 U.S. Route 1. This is so-called It's a Good Motel that burned about 18 months ago and is kind of sat vacant ever since. We're working with that property owner, and by June 1st, we expect that the half, if you will, of the building, there's actually, it's at an angle, the half that's been damaged will be removed. And the intent is to have the other units reoccupied. We are generally aware that the property, they're looking for a buyer, and so we'll do what we can. And Karen Martin at SEDCO is helping provide some assistance in that regard, too. So I just want to report that we're seeing progress there. And we've made efforts and will continue efforts on Scarborough Commons at the other end of Route 1 that burned last fall to really kind of jumpstart that process as well.
All right, and well, before we jump on it, Tom, we've had a lot of dates floating around this evening. Would you mind consolidating that down and then maybe circulating around?
Thank you. Yep.
Thank you.
So on to Councilmember Thomas, and we'll start on your end.
Thank you. Be brief. So I want to thank everyone, as well as the citizens that came for our workshop earlier tonight on the Pay As You Throw program. It did give a lot of food for thought, although I'll be honest with you, while I support the program 100% in its current format, it really is more about long-term planning around solid waste management and the investment needed for future costs around the landfill. I do think it's wise, hearing the consensus that we're going to be sending this, really taking this off the table at our next Finance Committee meeting, or I should say probably on the 29th. So I want citizens to know, I made a comment during that session, I think I'm the only person in town that has said that I like the program, because everyone I've talked to is very clear that they didn't like the program, and that's why I'm supporting sending this to a committee that can look at our true solid waste recycling and use programs. So I do appreciate that input. And I did want to mention, finally, a couple of things, and I'm not sure how to really say this, because one, I get emotional. So for, if I get their names right, Jason, Dave, Jake, and Mike. I got some of their last names, so I won't even try that. But, you know, and then also there's another person that commented at our last meeting, and I'm not going to mention the name, because, but it was a school board member who made a comment. And really I want to say that all of you actually inspire me, and the reason why that I do what I do, and I live here in Scarborough, and I serve, I'll tell you honestly that it's for very different reasons. The four young men that saved the homeowner, that's why we have a value-added community. And it's absolutely incredible, because no matter how big we get, it truly is a town and it truly is a family that makes this village, and I really appreciate what they did. To the school board member that made what I consider probably the most inappropriate comment, you are also the reason why I serve, because I realize that that type of opinion is not what this town is about, and we need more people to serve and to speak up. I can't believe anyone would suggest that if you don't like paying your taxes that you should leave.
Mm-hmm.
It's completely inappropriate for an elected official who's supposed to be a steward for the people to make that statement. It's a little bit harder and unacceptable for even a citizen to make it, but that's a little bit harder to control. So to some extent, I wish I had spoken up at the last meeting. I feel bad about that. I want to apologize for not having done so, because I think that we should have dealt with it right then. But I do say wholeheartedly that, one, I know that that is not representative of the other members of the school board. I know for a fact, knowing each of you, that it's not representative of this board either. And so that is the reason why I serve, too, and I really appreciate all of them, because everyone has their own opinion, but sometimes it's wrong. With, you know, just because you're thinking it doesn't mean you say it. So I just want to say thank you.
Yeah. I attended the Bella Vita open house and introduced myself to the manager and got a tour, and wanted to just report on the fact that it's a beautiful facility. For those of you who have gone by it 100 times and are wondering what really is inside, it's 80 units of assisted living. That's senior citizen housing with a very substantial amount of care, short of nursing care. And it has a, of those 80 units, 20 are for memory impairment. So that's what it's made up of, and it's, it really is a beautiful facility. They'll start having occupancy in May. I also attended today the volunteer fair sponsored by Piper Shores. I was there on behalf of our beach monitor program, recruiting volunteer beach monitors. This is a program that really is a lot of fun. I think if people realize that getting out on the beach for an hour a week, meeting other people, getting to know the endangered species that brings us out there primarily is a really enjoyable experience. So if you like to find an excuse to get out on the beach, call Town Hall. They will put you in touch with Ryan Wynn, the Plover Beach Coordinator, and he'll be able to fill you in on more details about the program. It was well attended today. It's a beautiful facility we have at Piper Shores. They were great hosts, and we had 5 people sign up, from the mostly 3 younger people, 2 younger people, and 3 older people from the Piper Shores community. Thank you.
Emery? I also would like to add my thanks to those young men who worked at that fire, who, as citizens, you know, noticed the fire and got involved. And I think, you know, if we all got more involved in our communities, it would all be a better place. And I have to brag that one of them is related to me, but that's another story. his great uncle, who was one of the founders of Engine 5, would be very proud of him. I'll say that. That's Michael Libby. Anyway, broadband. I'm looking at one of the members of the audience here. I haven't forgotten about broadband and working on what sort of expansion we do. I got an email from Karen Martin at SEDCO, who's been approached by a provider, and this is a movement and push on businesses around. So I'm Karen and I are going to be talking this week to see, again, how we can move this forward. I know Manager Hall's really busy with budgeting and whatever right now, but we haven't forgotten that, and we do want to see what we can do as a town. And that meeting at Higgins Beach, Councillor St. Clair, I looked up on my calendar, so I was like, I wasn't quite made. Next week is April 24th at 8 a.m. on a Friday morning, but we'll be starting that with the Higgins Beach. And I spent last week down in Charleston, South Carolina, and the reason I mention that is because I took pictures of all different beach use signs, and then there was flood. There's also the flood stuff that goes on that we'll be talking about with Higgins Beach. Mm-hmm. So I've got all sorts of information that I picked up on my vacation. So that's it.
Okay. I just wanted to say I'm sad that the woman that spoke earlier, she stayed for almost the entire thing. Tody, I'm assuming that you probably have her name and maybe where, what street she was on. She spoke at the podium.
Sure.
Yes. And spoke about what about taxes and you know, our elderly population. I think there's a lot of people in Scarborough that have a slight misconception that we actually do have a very large elderly population in Scarborough. We aren't just a school-based town. And the one thing that I wanted to say to her was we're not forgetting about them. And on the flip side of her point, there's also a lot of, including myself, single parents who are raising families in this town that also are concerned about our taxes being raised. And so I just want people to understand that I never speak for my other counselors, but I know that no one is taking this process lightly. It's a daunting task, and it's hard. It's very difficult to weigh all of the pieces, and unfortunately we're not always going to make everyone happy, but we're trying very hard to accommodate as many people as possible. I did, in regards to Sean, Counselor Babine, I did actually say something about the comment that was made by a member of the school board at our last meeting. And I found the comment that she made, I actually took it personal because that's me. I can't afford my taxes to keep being raised up, so should I leave? Well, I'm an active member of this town. My children have grown up here. They live here. They love this town. They go to school here. So I did. I personally took that very personal and hurtful. And I know a lot of other people did. And that is not something that I find acceptable behavior. And I hope that we never see that again. It's we all have opinions, and we have rights to those opinions. But we have a duty to this town. And like I said that night, their job is to make sure that they get everything they can for the schools. Our job as counselors is to make sure we get everything for the schools and the entire town. So that's a very hard situation to be in. So I'm done.
I'd just like to thank Tom and Mike Shaw for giving us a great presentation at the workshop, although the subject is way up in the air. It's a very interesting subject.
Yeah.
It certainly raised a lot of eyebrows, and I think I got as many emails about paying $2 a bag for garbage bags as I did for the high school budget.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be interesting to see how that flows out, and I'm sure we'll be able to come up with something in the future to increase our recycling and reduce our waste. And one other thing, I think everybody got a notice of the annual meeting for the Eastern Trail Alliance to be held down at the Old Marsh Country Club on May 14th from 5:30 to 8 p.m. I'm going to attend. Anybody else want to attend? Let me know.
Yeah, good evening, everybody, and I think I'm going to kind of build on, I think, some of the comments of my fellow counselors, and first for Council Donna, but I also visited the new facility at Oak Hill and looking for a place for my 95-year-old mom. I've looked at a lot of facilities. That is really an exceptional facility, so it's worth taking a look at. And then, too, I think just kind of building on some of the comments we've heard about Scarborough and a community and what makes us different, I think what I'd like to share is I'm really new to this process. As you know, I'm really new to the budget process. And what I've been overwhelmed with is the volume of emails that we have been getting around the budget issues. And I got to say, it's pretty evenly weighted, and it's really evenly weighted for people that really want to support the school and the budget. And it's really also we're hearing a lot from people that we heard about this evening, right? And as Kate has described, that people are really concerned about affordability and being here. And a couple things I'd say. One is we really need to come together as a community. What I'm getting in those emails is most of them are respectful and nice, and I know other counselors are getting them. But others are not so nice, and they really aren't open to listening and understanding and trying to make the right decisions for our community. And let me just kind of give you, at least from my perspective, what I'm hearing from people that have the affordability issue, it really seems genuine, and it really is the stories we've heard. Each one's personalized. For people that are supporting the budgets, I've heard every single email almost has exactly the same four themes, and I really want to pick up on them because I think it's really important for this community to have an honest conversation and to have a conversation that's based on fact, and so that's the only way we're going to be able to have a good conversation. So the four things that I've heard is that this school system has had dramatic, significant cuts over the last several years. And when you look at the numbers, at least the numbers that I look at, from 2011 to 2016, there's actually been about $11 million increase in the school budget. So when you hear about a budget cut, the world I come from, that means you get less money than the year before. There's no year since 2011 that they've actually gotten less money. But as I said, the schools have gotten 11 point. It's a 40% increase in that time period. It averages about 8% a year. Inflation during that same time period has only been 8% the whole time. So we're spending four times the inflation rate for the school budget. So I think that's just an important fact. There aren't budget cuts. The way they're describing cuts is if you ask, and I've been in the budget, I've written budgets, I've approved budgets, I was in accounting. A budget cut isn't, when you do a budget, you ask for the pie in the sky, fully expecting that that's going to be some change to that. So that's one thing I hear. The second thing that I hear is, it's really, these budget cuts have really decreased the quality and the reputation of the Scarborough school system. But if you look at the facts, they're ranked, it's been consistently ranked the top 10 schools in the state of Maine. So, again, it's really important to look at information. The third thing that you hear is that their property values are suffering because we're not invested in the school systems. Well, Scarborough, and actually one of the issues we're dealing with, is Scarborough has actually had some of the fastest appreciation in real estate in the state of Maine. It's appreciated at 5.9%. The national average is 5.3%. So it really hasn't impacted property values yet. And the other thing I hear that really kind of really upsets me, we really need to have a saying that people are unwilling in this town to invest in education. And I just gave you some numbers, but all anybody has to do is drive by Wentworth, or better yet, go inside the Wentworth school. This community is making significant investments in education. So I just think all of us need to have a good conversation. And what's really struck me this year as we talk about resources, we've heard in some of the budget proceedings that there are some real issues in other parts of the town. So, for instance, the fire and rescue department shared with us, they're having some staffing issues to staff nighttime services. So, again, I think we need as a community to decide where those resources need to go, what we're willing to pay, and to make really good decisions and respect other people's point of views. Everybody has an opinion. We need to find a way to work together. And I'll just echo, just suggest that we're going to say to somebody, if you can't afford the taxes in this town, you're living beyond your means and you should move, is not the answer for our community. So I appreciate everybody working together. Stay engaged, get informed, get the information, and let all of us know. And I appeal to actually all council members and also all the Board of Education members. When you see letters or emails that come to us that does not contain correct information, I think we have an accountability and obligation to try to point out what the real information is so everybody's working from a good set of facts. So I guess with that, I'll conclude. Thank you.
And last but not least, me.
So I did want to bring up one thing that Tody nudged me with, is there is a volunteer link for the piping pullovers if you're interested in doing the monitoring program. That's right on the town webpage. Mm-hmm. So again, if there's anybody interested, they can hop right online and do that. I made a conscious choice not to directly comment on what I had hoped was me not hearing a comment quite right at the last meeting. And I think I will just reiterate a few of my comments from then, since we're all talking about it at the moment. The school advocates for what the best interests and the needs and the wants are for the students of this community. And that is the difference between the school board and the council. The council has to take the whole entire package into consideration. And as I said at the meeting, certainly given the scope and the depth of what we faced as a community over these last 2 years, we have now come to an issue of outpacing even the most savvy of financial planning. There is a balance, and I think I have preached this every single year that I've been here. There is a balance to it. And I, yes, have children in those schools, and then I take that and I take their education very seriously. But I also have deep roots in this community, and I have parents that live here. I have in-laws that live here. I have grandparents. I have great aunts. I have great uncles. And everybody is, you know, willing to, on some level, appreciate and understand that there is a give and there is a take. So I don't ask one group any more than the other group to sacrifice. I say we will come together, and as may remember, one of these terms I offered, as I hope as a group that we could remember when we first started into this year, is agree to disagree. Hmm. And ultimately, a Judy Roy term, which I have always loved, is the best for the most with the least. So I will try to always do the best job I can for the most people that I can with the least impact. So certainly, you know, I look for that balance every year. I do want to comment that Jean Marie and I did have a conversation today. I might be throwing her under the bus a little bit.
That's okay.
About from budgets and how budgets come to be in this cat and mouse game every year. And, you know, there has been a lot of feedback that I've gotten in emails about, you know, a cap and why didn't we set this and what. Certainly we could make a policy as a council, but common policies are not laws. They can be broken, they can be amended, they can be. So what, to address that question, what are some options? And so certainly Jean Marie and I are going to talk about it a little more, and I told her I would present her with some of my thoughts on that, just from my experience here and where I see that some form of a cap and referendum and try to bring some stability, and where would that play? The other last thing I might just mention is I actually do reply to those emails. I gave up trying to carbon copy everybody
because
there's something odd going on in our email. So I'm getting the email, then my email back to me when I reply, and all of yours.
Right.
So I've got 8 emails for the one. So I've given up. If there's a question or you know, something that I'm answering, I'm carbon copying you guys in, but just straight up emails, I'm not. So outside of that, that is my last thought for this evening. So item number 12 is adjournment.
So moved.